Okay, so yeah, as Justin went over, I'm going to be running through the Capture the Flag event from Codebash 2020. If you've participated in Capture the Flag events in the past, this may be a little bit different because if you're not aware, Codebash is a developer conference, and so the CTF is made to be very friendly to all amounts of experience with Capture the Flag events as well as not. That way, if you have not experienced Capture the Flag event before, you can start on this one and get your legs under you and then move on to others. Also, just a point of note, last year was actually my first time doing these. Somebody that attends here frequently actually basically unknowingly roped me into it, and I was kind of hooked, and now I definitely focus on this. Last year I had a blast. This year, this was a big part of my enjoyment of the conference, was just going through these Capture the Flag puzzles. And so, to give a little bit of background on that as well, if you furthermore don't even know what a Capture the Flag is, you are presented with a series of puzzles that have solutions, often in a known format. In this case, Codebash definitely follows that. The format is fairly well known. That way, you have a little bit of a feedback loop when you find what's known as a flag, because you're capturing the flags. You'll have more confidence that you've done so effectively. And so basically, because it's Capture the Flag for a developer conference, or in the case of information security, there's often Capture the Flag events, these are all pretty much digital challenges. There is an element of a physical challenge that I won't be able to demo for you tonight because I forgot to do the pieces parts, but I'll kind of give you an idea of what that was like because that was pretty nifty this time around. Does anybody have any questions so far? Did I cover CTF and whatnot at enough depth that everybody's kind of comfortable with the idea of what it is?
Are they actual flags?
No, they're not flags. They're strings of characters. In this case, they look kind of like GUIDs, if you're familiar with those at all. That's a good question. That'd be kind of cool if they were, actually. Mike, we need to get on that. Oh, that's something I should cover. Mike ran it for at least 2 years, maybe three, right? 2 years. Ran Capture the Flag for Codebash for 2 years, so I'm sure he'll have plenty to say and plenty to correct me on. But another local personality, Bill Senf, has run it this year, right? He took over this year? Yeah. Oh, last year. So he's run it for 2 years. So wait a minute, you guys are ripe for rotation here. Somebody else needs to take it on. But yeah, it was a lot of fun. You like my alliteration? I'm good at this. There's going to be plenty of audience involvement, so if you know, you were expecting otherwise. Came to the wrong one. Oh, you've actually got a picture of it.
I've got a video of it.
Okay, well, you can play that later.
Okay.
Don't spoil it yet.
Okay.
Okay. Any more questions? No hands? No hands? Okay, I'm going to go ahead and dive into it then. First thing that I'm going to do is talk about kind of my approach to some of these. I am a developer, and so the first thing that I do is fire up Python. Because a lot of these challenges I like to try and solve with command line tools, and in particularly Python. That's my language of choice in general. And of course, I grabbed the most recent version as of that time, 3.8.1. So I've got Python version set up. I also have some other tools that I get in advance and that I also accumulate during the practice of working through these puzzles. One of my favorite tools is something called CyberChef. It's a website, but it also comes as a package that you can download and run locally, so you don't have to be online to get it, and you don't have to worry about submitting stuff online. I actually recently discovered that they do publish a Docker container, if you're familiar with that technology at all. They do publish a Docker container for it, and so that's kind of nifty too, and I've got that running at home on one of my computers. That way I can just cycle it and update it as needed. But highly recommend CyberChef. I might pop it open a little bit later and show you what it looks like, but it can just do a whole bunch of different kind of operations that are useful in solving these puzzles. Some of the other stuff that's in here are Java disassemblers, not JavaScript, Java disassemblers. Kind of makes me feel dirty to even say that word, but they were necessary for some of this, so I went ahead and grabbed those as well. Another thing that I'll note is I noticed a lot of these challenges were a little bit, how do I put it, not friendly with macOS, which was interesting to me. You had to have Windows to solve a couple of them. And so having a machine that can fire up some virtual machines can often be helpful. If you have any kind of code exploits or whatnot, same thing there, having a machine that's native for the binary that you're trying to exploit can be useful to have. So advice, if you ever go trying to solve any of these, having a MacBook Air that has 128 gigs of space is probably not your best platform to do it. What can I say? I like to play hard mode. So that's my general toolbox. That's kind of the stuff that I pull down to get started. Now we'll go ahead and jump into the challenges themselves. This year they were categorized, a whole bunch of different categories: access control, binary analysis, binary deserialization, encoding, encryption, incident response, mobile, on-site challenges, which is the fun one that I haven't recreated. It was in meat space, so to speak, social engineering, and web security. My two cents, some of these categories were a little bit odd and things didn't quite fit. Others of them, it was pivotal to pay attention to what category it was in to give you an idea of what the right path was to follow for the challenge, for the puzzle that you're trying to solve. So given all of these, can you guys read that okay at the moment? Nobody's complaining. Okay, next thing I've got to ask is I need somebody to pick one of those categories. Shout it out, anybody. Huh?
Mobile.
Okay, we'll start with mobile. So, I also have a disease. Why did you do this to iOS? I have a disease. I have to organize everything on my computer. I'm a digital hoarder, so in this case, of course, I've got mobile. The only challenge in mobile is why did you do this to us, iOS? It was worth 200 points, and as I went through these, I would create these little text files to kind of lead myself through. Why did you do this to us? 200 points. This is actually the body of the challenge. This is kind of the first hint that was given. Probably shouldn't leave the flag there. And then what was also interesting this year is all of the challenges, all of the puzzles, were community generated. People that were interested in playing the CodeMash CTF were the ones that actually created them. But that did mean that there were some interesting release cycles going on. So in this case, they had an incorrect file and they had to then replace it. So I also kind of shorthand documented my steps of going through this. So first things first, download the file, and I should pop open the files over here. I download the file, and it's a ctf1.ipa file, which is a macOS application file, basically. iOS packaged app, I think, is IPA. Don't quote me on that. But the interesting thing about IPA is that it can actually be extracted. It's an archive. And so I started by renaming it with .zip, just to get my extractor of choice, Kika, K-E-K-A. It's got a fun icon. I got that up and running with it, extracted it. The extracted file then had an info plist, and actually the extracted file is this payload. And so I started digging through it, and what I noticed was that there were a lot of files in here, a lot of files that I had no idea where to be looking for this thing. So I just ran strings across the entire thing. That didn't help much either. Eventually, I found this very interesting value called flag, which probably would be the thing that I should have looked for in the past. Actually, that's another side note here. I often go too far. I think too hard about these challenges, particularly given the audience that they were crafted for. I don't know why, but my brain just goes off in the distance. Last year, I had a real fun one where it was a buffer overflow that you had to trigger. And so attending NEOISF and attending other security things besides in the surrounding areas and whatnot, I, of course, immediately tried to remember what Doug had taught me. And I'm digging through my mind going, okay, I know I need this, I know I need that, I'm going to have to do a NOP sled because it's going to drop me in another location, and in order to get the overflow, and I just went out of control. Yeah, no, it was really as simple as just passing a command line argument that was bigger than the amount you needed. That's all. I just had to pass a big not even the right sized, just too big of a command line argument, and it triggered the exploit. So I do that a lot. I did that a lot in this case. If I would have just searched for the word flag, I probably would have found it a lot quicker, but eventually then I did find flag with this value. I went and then decoded the value, which was quite a process because they were represented as individual ASCII decimal characters, not ASCII hexadecimal characters, which I was not expecting. So that was kind of fun. I basically ended up doing this one sort of by hand. I decoded it. I used this lookup table that I listed here of the decimal equivalents of ASCII to go through. I broke out the individual, and then I went, okay, well, I need this one. Okay, 50 is 2. And I would just go through and do that process. So the flag ended up looking like this. CM20-K3Y5-ST0R-D1NA-PLST. Code match 20, keys stored in a P list. And that's what the flags look like. And so that's what we're going to be looking at throughout all of these. Did everyone kind of follow the process that I managed to go through to get this time?
Yeah.
Awesome. Well, that's that challenge. Now we get to go through the game again. Somebody shout a category, any of them except for mobile.
Encryption.
Oh, encryption was a fun one. So we had two challenges in encryption. I'm actually going to start out with this second one called Where's the Bacon? They had a lot of fun names. So Where's the Bacon featured a form of encryption called the Bacon Cipher. Okay, that's a thing, yeah. It was interesting, to say the least. This one I don't have as verbose notes on, but basically the challenge just gave you this chunk here. And the Bacon Cipher, if you're not familiar with it, it's an interesting substitution cipher where you're substituting a larger chunk for the smaller chunk, right? And so you can kind of equate it to the way that you would represent a given value in bits. We've got 0, 1, 0, 0, 1, that sort of thing. Well, this is kind of like that. So we've got A, 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 B, A, which is C. A, 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 B, A, B, B, which is M. And you go down the chain and you decode all of them, and what you get out the other end is the flag. Now, in this case, I did have an extra step that I had to do. I first had to realize that it was a Baconian cipher. Yes, it's actually real. Go on Wikipedia, I promise. But the next thing I had to do was substitute these, because in most of the places where you would decode this, Baconian cipher uses A's and B's. This one obviously used C's and M's. I probably, if I was really trying to make a stretch goal, could have written a Python decoder that used C's and M's, but in this case, I literally just subbed all of the letter C's for A and all the letter M's for B and got through it. So that was the 100.1.
So in that situation, do they give you like a clue as to here's the ciphers that are potentially used in all the CTF?
They do not. I literally just started Googling encryption bacon. Thankfully, I didn't have image search turned on. That would have been really weird. But, yeah, it was like the first or second result. The other thing is you can play a bit of a metagame. And so a lot of the times the themes for the CTFs out there, particularly at this level, are fairly generic. And so I very much expect that I will play another CTF in the future, again, at this level, that will use the Baconian cipher. And so then it becomes kind of a found knowledge of, oh, I remember, I did that last time. I don't have to Google for it this time. That sort of thing. The other thing that I would recommend is CyberChef that I mentioned actually has it built in. And so that's another thing, is you can kind of poke around in there and be like, hey, what are some of the operations here that might relate to it? I expect, actually, if I would have just typed bacon into CyberChef's search box, that it probably would have filtered that. And it would be like, oh, got it, and off to the races. Excellent. So the next one was a little bit harder. First one, where's the bacon? Second one, what is missing? This one, once again, I did not do the greatest job of documenting, unfortunately. These ones were actually early on. These are some of the ones that I first kind of started with. And so again, I like Python. I also like Visual Studio Code for this kind of stuff. I think I have... Nope, not gonna work, never mind. So, long story short, the file for this one is this index.html. And I can at least turn on wrap. And you can see that within this HTML, actually, I can probably even view in Finder. Actually, let me